Πρωτοστάτης ουρανώθεν επέμφθη, υπήν τη Θεοτόκο το χαίρε.
Ευγεία Θεοτόκο.
άγγελος πρωτοστάτης ουρανόθεν επέμφθη, υπήν τη Θεοτόκο το χαίρε. Άγγελος πρωτοστάτης ουρανόθεν επέμφθη, υπήν τη Θεοτόκο το χαίρε. Συν τη ασωμάτω φωνή σωματουμενών σε θεωρών Κύριε, εξίστατο και ίστατο κραυγάζων προς αυτήν τη αυτά. Χαίρε δεις η χαρά εκλάμψη, χαίρε δεις η αρά εκλείψη, χαίρε του πεσόντος Αδάμ η ανάκλησης, χαίρε των δακρύων της Εύας η λύτρωσης. Χαίρε ύψος δυσανάβατον ανθρωπίνης λογισμής. Χαίρε βάθος δυσθεώρητον και αγγέλων οφθαλμής. Χαίρε ότι υπάρχεις βασιλέως καθέδρα, χαίρε ότι βαστάζεις τον βαστάζοντα πάντα, χαίρε αστήρ εμφαίνων των ηλίων, χαίρε γαστήρ εν Θεού σαρκώσεως, χαίρε δεις ρεφουγείτε η κτήσεις, χαίρε δεις βρε φουργείτε ο κτίστης, χαίρε νύμφοι ανύμφευτε. Φυσί το Γαβριήλ Θαρσαλέος, το παράδοξον σου της φωνής, δυσπαράδεκτον μου τη ψυχή φαίνεται, ασπόρου γαρ συλλήψεως την γύζην, πως λέγεις κράζον αλληλούια. A pure womb, how can a son be born? Tell me. He spoke to her in fear, only crying out. Rejoice, initiate of an ineffable counsel. Rejoice, faith in things that demand silence, rejoice, beginning of Christ's wonders, rejoice, crown of his teachings, rejoice, heavenly ladder by which God came down, rejoice, bridge leading those from earth to heaven, rejoice, wonder well known among the angels, rejoice, wound much lamented by the demons, rejoice, for ineffably you gave birth to the light, rejoice, for to none you revealed the mystery, rejoice, you that surpass the knowledge of the wise, rejoice, you that pour light on the minds of the believers, rejoice, O bride unwedded. High then overshadowed the conception, the one who knew no wedlock, and he made her womb fruitful as a fertile field for all who wish to reap salvation as they sing Hallelujah. Σα Θεοδόχων η Παρθένος την Μήτραν ανέδραμε προς την Ελισάβετ το δε βρέφος εκείνης ευθύς επιγνούν τον ταύτης ασπασμών έχερε και άλμασιν ως άσμασιν ευώα προς την Θεοτόκον. Χαίρε βλαστού αμαράντου κλίμα, χαίρε καρπού ακυράτου κτήμα, χαίρε γεωργών γεωργούσα φιλάνθρωπων, χαίρε φυτουργών της ζωής ημών φίουσα, χαίρε άρουρα βλαστάνουσα εφορίαν ικτυρμών, χαίρε τράπεζα βαστάζουσα ευθυνίαν ηλασμών. Χαίρε ότι λιμώνα της τρυφής αναθάλης, χαίρε ότι λιμένα των ψυχών ετοιμάζεις, χαίρε δεχτών πρεσβείας θυμίαμα, χαίρε παντός του κόσμου εξύλασμα, χαίρε Θεού προς θνητούς ευδοκία, χαίρε θνητών προς Θεών παρησία, χαίρε νύμφη ανήμφευτε. Ψήγαμον υπονών άμεμπτε, μαθών δέσου την σύλληψη εκ Πνεύματος Αγίου, έφη, Αλληλούια. Χάρις και η αγάπη του Θεού μας χάρισε άλλη μια φορά στη ζωή μας την ευκαιρία να ζήσουμε και να γιορτάσουμε αυτό το πολύ μεγάλο και σημαντικό χρονικό της Μεγάλης Αγίας και Μεγάλης Τεσσαρακοστής, στην πρώτη εβδομάδα της οποίας ήδη έχουμε εισέλθει. Πρώτη εβδομάδα η οποία έχει, εκτός από τις προηγιασμένες, έχει σήμερα την πρώτη ακολουθία των χαιρετισμών. Ευχαριστώ ιδιαιτέρως τον πατέρα Ιωάννη, τον καλόποιμένα αυτής της ενορίας, για την πρόσκληση να έμεθα και πάλι μαζί. Ευχαριστώ τους ψάλτες μας, οι οποίοι ψάλλουν, τα παιδιά τα οποία πρέπει να περάσουν στο ιερό. You have to go inside. Thank you for standing. And τον κύριο Πανάγο, ο οποίος όπως πάντα βιντεοσκοπεί την ακολουθία. Ευχαριστώ ιδιαιτέρως τόσο τον πρέσβη, γενικό πρόξενο της Κύπρου, τον κύριο Φιλίππου, όσο και την πρόξενο της Ελλάδος, του ελληνικού προξενείου, την κυρία Ζωχιού, που είναι μαζί μας απόψε. Είναι πάντα μαζί μας τόσο το ελληνικό γενικό προξενείο, όσο και το κυπριακό γενικό προξενείο. Και ευχαριστώ όλους όσοι είναι απόψε κοντά μας σε αυτόν τον όντως ειδικό εορτασμό της πρώτης ακολουθίας των χαιρετισμών. The Great Lenten Period offers to us a tremendous spiritual opportunity to live for a number of weeks, 42 days until Sunday, Palm Sunday, and then one more week, the Holy Week, to live in a course by which we gradually will come to the very center of our faith, which is the cross and resurrection of Christ. This whole period, these weeks, until Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and then Holy Saturday and Pascha, are leading to that kind of event, because this is the heart of our faith. As St. Paul declared, I declare Christ crucified and risen, a scandal to the Jews, a foolishness to the Greeks, the pagans, but for us, the power and the wisdom of God, Jesus Christ, the crucified and risen. Central person in the great mystery of God, which was God becoming human being. Central person is the very Virgin Mary of Nazareth. This simple, all pure, all saint, all impeccable, all wonderful young lady who had the unique mystery, an opportunity to become the mother not of a human son or child, but the mother of the Son of God and Son of Man. And this is why in the chanting tonight, in the salutation part, we heard about a mystery in need of silence. The incarnation of God through a human being and the appearance on earth of a unique being which is full God and full human being is something defying any language, any description, any way of expressing what is behind this great mystery. Have you ever thought how Panagia was feeling as she was carrying in pregnancy someone who was not conceived by human means? What an experience. To say it was a unique experience, it's very poor an expression. It's something just beyond words, something that St. Ignatius in the year of 95 said, when he said, one of the very mysteries of God, the pregnancy and birth of Christ through a human being. So this is why tonight and during this period, the Church provides us with all the means of being able to really go as deep as possible into this ineffable, unspeakable, unbelievable miracle of a God becoming human being. Because we deal with something, as I said, that is beyond human experience. This is why the Church provides us all possible means to come as close as possible to this great mystery. And the akathist is one of the expressions in language of this mystery. Because what happens with this akathist hymn? If you read it from the beginning, from Alpha to Omega, because in the 24 stanzas, we have the 24 stanzas starting in succession with one of the letters of alphabet. Alpha, Beta, Gamma, Delta, Epsilon, till Omega. What happens if you read carefully? The story that the akathist says is the story of the Annunciation, Conception, Birth, and Passion of Christ. How we started? Angelos protostatis uranothen epemphi ipinti theotokoto here. The angel, the head, the chief of the angels came to the Virgin Mary to tell her hail. And then what follows is he announces that she is going to become the mother of God. Second stanza, βλέπωσα η Αγία εαυτήν εν αγνία, φυσί το Γαβριήλ θαρσελέως. Seeing the Virgin Mary, that she was a virgin and an impeccable person, addresses the angel, how is it possible? And the next stanza, γνώσιν άγνωστον γνούνε. At that point, the Virgin Mary would like to know something that was totally unknown, totally unconventional, totally out of any well-known reality. And the angel explains what happens. And then, δύναμις του υψίστου, the power of the Lord then comes like a shadow on the Virgin Mary, and she conceives the Son of God and Son of Man. We proceed, the next stanza, the birth, the shepherds, then the Magi, Herod killing the babies. You go continuously. And then baby Jesus is presented to Simeon. We are in the letter M, Melondos Simeonos. You see, what happens is a continuous narrative of the Annunciation, Conception, Birth, and just presented of Christ to the temple. And then we go to the end of this story. But what happens? This is a masterpiece of literature and theology, because after the narrative that describes what happened so that finally the Son of Man came on earth, then we hear this hail, here, which is a constant hymn to the Mother of God. It's a mixing of a narrative telling the history of the Incarnation, a mixing of this with a superb kind of hymn without end, praising the Theotokos. And combining in this part, in every stanza of the 24, combining whatever we know from Old and New Testament about the coming of God on earth. So when we come at some point to the letter N, as we are going to have it as we proceed with the weeks of Lenten, we hear Nean edixe ktisin. The Lord God showed a new creation by realizing this kind of birth from a human being, of someone who is full God and full human being. And after that, in a subtle way, the poet and composer of the hymn, he goes to the letter X, the Greek letter X, Xenon edixe tokon. He had shown a strange kind of birth. Therefore, let us be disconnected, goes the hymn, from this world and go to the land of the Theotokos. And so we are going to reach at the very last, the fourth week, in the end of this Akathist. And here, hymnos in the letter Y, hymnos apas itate synectineste spevdon ton son uranion chrimaton. Every praise, every doxology is defeated in trying to describe what happened. It's a beautiful expression. Reaching the end, we feel, goodness, we were unable to grasp and describe and project the magnitude and the depth and the unheard of, the mystery of God becoming human being through a human being, the Virgin Mary. And we are going to hear at the very end, O panimite mater, itekusa ton pandon agion agiota ton logon. O Mother, you are worthy of all hymns, and who gave birth to the Holy of Holies, Son of God. It's an amazing text, an amazing poem, a wonderful hymn. There is no end in chanting him. In some Orthodox churches, the Akathist is chanted throughout the year, not only during Lenten period, because it's something we never are satisfied by chanting and offering it to God. And this is why, in talking about the Mother of God, we have an accumulation of all superlative expressions in order to be able to say something. That's what you have Panagia, Panagnos, Pansemnos, Panamomos. We are going to hear after a while, Aspile, Amoliende, Aphthore, Acharande. An accumulation of adjectives and words describing the nature of Theotokos as the most pure, the most holy, the most humble, and the most beautiful as human being. I would like to close with one more observation. If you read carefully the Gospels, in their order in the New Testament, Gospel of Matthew, Gospel of Mark, Gospel of Luke, Gospel of John, you have in the initial chapters of the Gospel of Matthew and Luke the description of the Annunciation, conception and birth of Christ. Not in the Gospel of Mark, he starts with the ministry of Christ, and in the Gospel of John we have an unusual beginning about God being Logos, the second person of the Holy Trinity, becoming flesh. And you have there the mentioning of the Panagia Mary of Nazareth. Follows some description of what happened after that, the flight to Egypt to avoid the massacre by Herod. You have the return to Nazareth after the death of Herod. You have an episode when Jesus was 12 years old and left behind in Jerusalem in a pilgrimage. And then you go to the beginning of the Gospel of John, and you have the beginning of the miracles of Christ during the wedding in Cana. There you see again the Mother of God. And there she says to Christ, they are now out of wine. And Jesus said, it's not my time yet. But then Panagia said to the waiters, do whatever he tells you. After that, you go through the Gospels, and there is one or two more cases when Panagia is mentioned in an event when Jesus is preaching in a house, and they tell him, your mother and your relatives are waiting, wanting for you. And he said, my mother, my relatives are the people of God who listen to the word of God. Panagia is not mentioned. Is not there, is not present. She is present again for the last time in the Gospel of John by the cross of Christ. So we have the Panagia at the very beginning of two Gospels, just then in the episode of the 12 years old Jesus, in the wedding in Cana, just an accidental visit to some place when Jesus was preaching, and then by the cross. The most glorious human being ever on earth is constantly absent, is constantly not in the scene with Jesus. This is the utmost of humility, of dignity, of discreet attitude. She is by the side, never on stage. It's a terrific thing. Think about that. Very few instances, and just the tragic finale by the cross, she is there. She's there in order to taste the worst and most intense pain a human being ever experienced. Seeing Jesus in the age of 33 dying as a criminal on a cross. But in any other cases, just not in front, not projecting herself, not telling the people, you know, I am the Mother of God, and this, no, nothing of that. It's a lesson to us. It's a lesson to us human beings in modern times who are victims of self-projection, self-aggrandizement. Here is the greatest human being, just disappearing, not taking advantage of the tremendous privilege of being the mother of this Jesus. So whatever we accumulate in terms of human language to praise her, it would be just not simply insufficient, would be nothing. Let ask her to be with us. Let her teach us this humility, this, there is a Greek word, semnotis, in addition to purity, in addition to holiness, in addition to impeccability, just semnotis, this combination of humility, decency, dignity, discreetness, etc. And ask her to be always with us, not only as a assistance, invincible assistance, not as a comforter, but as someone who leads us to this great characteristic of a real human being, which is semnotis, the real understanding of what we are and what we are compared to the great God. So let us now continue and complete our really very inspiring service tonight and offering our hymns to her and to her Son, our Lord, God, and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.